ज जनरंजना यमुना तीरा वनचारी जय राधा माधवा कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे श्री हरिनाम संकीर्तन की जय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 31, Chapter entitled The Disappearance of Lord Shri Krishna, Text 19 and 20. Pranamscha vijahustatra Bhagavad virahatura Upaguhya patimstata चिताम आरुरुहु स्त्रियः प्राणांश्च विजहुस्तत्र भगवत विरहातुरः उपगुह्य पतिंस्तात चिताम आरुरुहु स्त्रियः प्राणांश्च विजहुस्तत्र भगवत विरहातुरः उपगुह्य पतिंस्तात चिताम आरुरुः स्त्रियः प्राणांश्च विजहुस्तत्र भगवत विरहातुरा उपगुह्यः पतिंस्तात चितामारुरुः स्त्रियः प्राणांश्च विजहुस्तत्र भगवत विरहातुरा उपगुह्यः पतिंस्तात चितामारुरुः स्त्रियः प्राणांश्च विजहुस्तत्र prana, their lives, cha, and vijahu, they gave up, tatra, their bhagavat, from the personality of Godhead, viraha, because of separation, atura, tormented, upaguhya, embracing, patin, their husbands, tata, my dear Parikshit, chita, the funeral pyre, aruruhu, they climbed upon, striyaha, the wives. Translation by the disciples of His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. Translation. Tormented by separation from the Lord, His parents gave up their lives at that very spot. My dear Parikshit, the wives of the Yadavas then climbed onto the funeral pyres, embracing their dead husbands. This verse doesn't have a purport, so we'll just read the next verse. Rama patnyascha taddeham upaguhyagnim avishan vasudeva patnyas tadgatram pradyumnadin hare snusha krishna patnyo visan agnim rukminyadyas tadatmaka. Translation. The wives of Lord Balaram also entered the fire and embraced his body. And Vasudev's wives entered his fire and embraced his body. The daughters-in-law of Lord Hari entered the funeral pyres of their respective husbands headed by Pradyumna. And Rukmini and the other wives of Lord Krishna, whose hearts were completely absorbed in him, entered his fire. Purport. It is understood that the anguished scene described here is a display of the Lord's illusory potency, adding a final dramatic note to Lord Krishna's pastimes on the earth. In reality, Lord Krishna returned to his eternal abode in his original body, and his eternal associates returned with him. This final heartbreaking scene of the Lord's pastimes is a creation of the Lord's internal potency that brings the Lord's manifest pastimes to a perfect dramatic end. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guroho Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tamsajivam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So we are coming to the end of this particular pastimes of the disappearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in this particular Leela. And these series of verses, repeatedly it has been described that one shouldn't take these incidents, one shouldn't see these pastimes as reality, but see them as a dramatic manifestation of the Lord's pastimes. And this particular verse describes how the queens of the different Yadavas, they are climbing onto the funeral pyres of their husbands and leaving their bodies just like any other mortal human being. And we've also heard that how this is specifically to confuse the atheists, to give them a reason to believe that, yes, the Supreme Lord, because the Lord says, if you want to believe that, you know, I am impersonal, look, here is some help for you. So, but then the Acharyas explain that this is just a display of the Lord's illusory potency. This is not to be considered as a reality. This is just like a drama that's happening. Queen Kunti, in his prayers to Lord Krishna, she explains, Maya Javanika Channam Agya Dhokshajam Avyayam Na Lakshase Moodha Drisha Nato Natyo Dharo Yathaha. That being beyond the range of limited sense perception, you are the eternally irreproachable factor covered by the curtain of the deluding energy. You are invisible to the foolish observer, exactly as an actress, exactly as an actor dressed as a player is not recognized. And we have that experience when we go to watch the drama festival, we try to spot out, you know, which is the actor, who is that Prabhuji who is playing the part, because we know that there is a difference between the act, the persona that's there on the stage and the actual personality. And therefore, the Lord speaks in the Gita also, Avajananti mam moodha, manushim tanum ashritaha, param bhavam ajananto mam bhuta maheshwaram. Fools deride me when I descend in the human form. They do not know my transcendental nature as the Supreme Lord of all that be. So here Krishna is explaining about himself, that what you are saying is not true. My transcendental form is something different. And the scriptures, they repeatedly try to hint at us that just like the pastimes of the Lord, the living being also here in this material world, they are also covered by Maya. And the living being also is considering his temporary existence here, the temporary situation, as reality. And saying so, the living entity also identifies, interacts, and invests in the material connections that he has. In our school days, we read a play by William Shakespeare. The name of the play was As You Like It. And in that particular play, William Shakespeare, he composes a very beautiful poem. The title of the poem is All the World is a Stage. And he says, all the world is a stage and all the men and women merely players. All have their entrances and exits, and each person in his time plays seven parts, his acts being the seven ages, his acts being the different stages of his life. And then he goes on to describe all the different portions, that the different act that the living person plays. So we understand that, you know, when we read these pastimes, we have to actually understand these pastimes through the vision of the Acharyas. Because through that vision, we are able to understand the reality of our position. Through that vision, we are able to understand the reality of the transcendental position of the Supreme Lord and their associates. And we are also able to understand the hidden messages that the Lord wants us to grasp through his manifest pastimes. Because the pastimes of the Lord, he says, janma karma chame divyam. They are not like ordinary dealings of this material world. They are transcendental in nature. And this particular verse, we are seeing how the wives of the Yadavas, they are voluntarily entering into the funeral pyres of their husbands. And this is specifically the Vedic system of sati, or Prabhupada calls it the sahamaran. In the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Srila Prabhupada gives a very wonderful understanding of, you know, this culture, this rite that prevailed at that point of time. And he quotes from the Mahabharata, where Narad Muni is trying to console Yudhishthir Maharaj, when Yudhishthir Maharaj finds that Dhritarashtra and Gandhari, they are missing. And Yudhishthir Maharaj wants to search them out. And then Narad Muni describes that how Yudhishthira, how Dhritarashtra has actually left, and Gandhari has left along with him. And the purport Srila Prabhupada mentions that Gandhari, she was actually a very ideal, chaste lady, always close to her husband, a life companion of her husband. And therefore, when she saw her husband burning in the fire of mystic yoga, along with the cottage of leaves that he was staying in the forest, she despaired. She couldn't control herself. It is said that she had left home after seeing her 100 sons die. And now, when she saw her husband, you know, when the forest she saw her most beloved husband was also burning, she actually felt alone. And therefore, she entered the fire of her husband and followed her husband to death. And Prabhupada says, this entering of a chaste lady into the fire of her dead husband is called the sati rite. And then Prabhupada gives a very, very masterpiece statement. He says, a chaste wife like Gandhari would feel the separation of her husband to be more burning than actual fire. And he gives a clarification. Such a lady can observe the sati rite voluntarily, and there is no criminal force by anyone. But when the rite becomes a formality only, and the force was applied upon a lady to follow the principle, actually it became criminal. And therefore the ceremony was to be stopped by state law. So here we see this virtue of chastity being displayed by Gandhari and the Yadava queens. This word sati specifically means being chaste. And asati means being unchaste. And the Shastras, they say that these exalted personalities who actually took up this, you know, kind of very extreme step, they were unable to imagine a life without the association and service to their masters. And the Shastras, they repeatedly aim at also making us realize that how can you live a life without the association and service to your Supreme Master? This is the hidden, meaning that the Shastras want us to churn upon. And therefore, today we'll spend some time to learn from these ladies how to reignite our own chastity when it comes to reestablishing our connection with the Supreme Lord. And when we talk about this chastity, what does it actually mean? What does it mean to be chaste in our relationship with the Supreme Lord? What are those benchmarks by which we can evaluate our own chastity when we are trying to establish the connection with the Supreme? And what are the potential, pitfalls? Where can we go wrong when we are embarking on this journey of remaining chaste in our relationship with the Supreme? So we'll be discussing six facets of chastity, which if we keep in mind, we'll also become much chaste. What are those symptoms or characteristics of chastity that we learn from these great souls? Some parameters to evaluate if we are on the right track. So these six facets or these same symptoms or characteristics, the very first symptom I could point out was being committed. What is this commitment? Commitment is the willingness to go through anything to serve the master, whatever it may take. And the brilliant example of this commitment is Mother Sita. Srila Prabhupada writes in one of the purports in 9th Canto that whenever we find a description of an ideal chaste woman, Mother Sita is among them. And we know from Ramayana that how when Lord Ramchandra, he was asked by Dashrath Maharaj to go to the forest, Mother Sita was not asked to accompany him, but she voluntarily accepted that, penance. She had, all through her lives, she had been a, lady who had lived in a palace. And imagining the situation of this hardships, I mean, the Ramayana describes that how when she was trying to put on the tree bark, it was, it was just impossible for her. And Sumantra, he became very angry at Dasharatha Maharaj that how cruel a person are you to see such a exalted lady go through such tribulations. And it's also said that this commitment is something that's not a spike of enthusiasm. Commitment is something that is tested over time. And we know from the life of Mother Sita that when she was kidnapped by Ravana and she was there in the Ashok Vatika, she was practically hopeless, but still she had hope. They call it hope, having hope against hope. I mean, she didn't know, she was not tracking, like we order a Uber and we track. Kahan tak aa gaya hai gaadi, you know, till where. So she was not tracking the Vanar Sena, till how much has the Vanar Sena advanced and when they will be attacking and when I will get released. No, she was not having any expectation that will I ever be released from these clutches of the demon. And more so, she was being offered an entire kingdom made of solid gold. But then, it is said that Mandodari, who was another chaste lady, she could understand the chastity of Sita. And she reprimanded Ravana that better you know, return her back. Otherwise, it will prove to be very disastrous for you. But then here from the personality of Mother Sita, we see that how she exhibited her commitment over a period of time. Another example from the Ramayana is the commitment of Lakshman. Again, Lakshman, he also voluntarily accompanied Lord Ramchandra into the forest. And in the Panchavati, when you know, Ravana took the form of a deer and Lord Ram went chasing the deer. There, Ravana was misunderstood by Mother Sita, but still he didn't give up her service. You know, enough is enough. I never expected that, you know, I'll get to hear this. No, he heard it all, still he continued with his service. And it is explained that after Mother Sita, after the entire war was over and Mother Sita was rescued, Lord Ramchandra, he refused to accept Mother Sita, that you have been in the premises of another man, I cannot accept you. And there Mother Sita, she is asking her Lakshman to build a funeral pyre. Now, as a service, whatever it may take, you know, to serve, with a very heavy heart, Lakshmanji is building that funeral pyre for Mother Sita. And sure enough, we know that how Mother Sita enters that fire with the resolve that even if for a single moment there has been a discrepancy in my chastity, let the fire consume me. And sure enough, Agnidev himself came with the body and gives the, you know, testifies that Mother Sita was actually pure. And we also see that how, you know, later on when Lord Ram is ruling Ayodhya and there is this discussion happening in a particular house and a husband is chastising his wife that you have been out, how can I accept you? Do you think I am like Lord Ram that I can accept you? No. And the spies of Lord Ramchandra, they actually report this to Lord Ram. And Lord Ram says that, you know, my incarnation, my appearance is to uphold dharma, you know, as Maryada Purushottam. And therefore, he summons Lakshman and asks Lakshman to take Mother Sita to the ashram of Valmiki Muni. And again, Lakshmanji is taking Mother Sita. I mean, rendering these types of services over a period of time actually needs commitment. And therefore, it is said for a disciple, chastity means to be committed to his or her spiritual master. We see the beautiful example of His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada himself. He received these two instructions from his spiritual master that you are an intelligent young man, why don't you go to the Western world and preach the science of Krishna consciousness? This instruction he had received decades earlier, not just a few days, not just a few years, but decades earlier. But still Srila Prabhupada was committed. Repeatedly he was asking and finding out chances, finding out some opportunity by which he could fulfill the instruction of his spiritual master. Another instruction, if you ever get money, print books. Again, you know, these two displays around the altar, they are a testimony as how Srila Prabhupada, he fulfilled, you know, these two desires. How committed Srila Prabhupada was. So that was about the commitment, a very strong characteristic of being chaste. Unless and until a disciple is committed to this instruction of the spiritual master, there is no meaning to chastity. The second characteristic that I could think was being honest. Being honest in acknowledging one's own position before the master, and being honest in acknowledging the help that is provided by the master for one's spiritual upliftment. And a beautiful example in this case is of Sri Rukmini Devi. In the Krishna book, Srimad Bhagavatam 10th canto, we read how, you know, there is this beautiful conversation happening between Lord Krishna and Rukmini Devi. And Lord Krishna is giving many, many reasons, you know, how Rukmini Devi, she had committed a mistake by accepting Krishna as her husband. And of course, you know, hearing all this, Rukmini Devi faints and Krishna lifts her and, you know, consoles her and everything. And then Rukmini Devi, she actually refutes all of his arguments for her, for the wrong choice that Krishna was speaking. And of course, there is a long list of, you know, 10, 15 allegations and beautiful refutations. We don't have so much time to go through it all, but then we'll just take a maybe two, three of them, and we see how Rukmini Devi is specifically acknowledging her position with respect to the Lord. And she is acknowledging the help that the Lord renders for the living entity. So Krishna said that, terrified of other kings, I took shelter in the ocean, and we have become enemies of powerful men. You know, why? How could you accept, you know, such a fearful person like me, who out of fear took shelter in an ocean where no one can reach, and I picked up enmity with so many powerful men? And Rukmini Devi here is honest in acknowledging her position. He's saying that, yes, I am unsuitable for you, because no one can be equal to you. She's saying, Kvasve mahimni abhirato bhagavan stradhisha kvaham guna prakritir agyagrihita pada. She's saying, Kvasve mahimni abhirato bhagavan stradhisha. Kaha aap? You know, where is your position? Kvasve mahimni? You're such an exalted person. Bhagavan Striyadhisha, the Adhisha of the material creation, are the threefold deities, Lord Brahma, Lord Vishnu and Lord Shiva. And you are the Adhisha of these three personalities. You know, what to talk of your position and what to talk of me? She is comparing herself, Kwa aham guna prakriti. Prabhupada translates this guna prakriti as a woman of mundane qualities. Where you are the Adhisha of, you know, the superintendent of the three Adhisha, and where I am this woman of mundane qualities, Agya Grihita Pada, whose feet are grasped by fools, she's saying. And Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he speaks that Srila Rukmini Devi, in her extreme humility, she is identifying herself as a mundane woman. And therefore, here we see that a chaste servant just wants to serve. He understands the position of his master. He doesn't want to become like his master. And repeatedly we have seen in his classes, in his instructions, how Srila Prabhupada repeatedly thrashes the Mayavad conception, the Mayavadis, because they want to take the position of the Supreme Lord. So that is the first aspect of honesty. Of chastity, be honesty in acknowledging one's position with respect to the Supreme. The second aspect of honesty is acknowledging the help being offered to the Lord. So the Lord said that, I was fearful of the kings. And Rukmini Devi is saying that actual kings are the modes of material natures, because they keep everyone under their control. And Krishna, you take shelter in the hearts of the ocean of the oceanic hearts of your devotees, so that the modes of material nature can't affect them. You protect your devotees from these kings, these modes of material nature. And then Krishna is saying that I took up enmity with the powerful, and Rukmini Devi is refuting that, saying, yes, you have entered within the hearts of the devotees, and these powerful are the material senses of the living entity, who are very, very powerful. And because you have taken shelter in the hearts of your devotees, you are fighting on behalf of your devotees, and you have taken up this battle against sense gratification on the part of your devotees, and thus you are constantly trying to help them in their struggle for spiritual purity, Rukmini Devi is saying. In other words, a chaste devotee knows that all my ability of, you know, counteracting these modes, of controlling these senses, is only because of the help that the Supreme Lord gives us. If that help is withdrawn, you know, we'll be back to square one. And therefore, a devotee wants to always give credit. He doesn't want to take credit. He is honest in giving that credit to the Supreme Lord. That is the aspect of chastity. The next aspect of chastity I thought of discussing was one's affection for the master. Unless and until a servant has affection for his master, there is no meaning to chastity. And therefore, there are these two characteristics of affection. One is that a chaste servant always wants to establish the supremacy of his master. He doesn't leave any stone unturned, you know, when it comes to glorifying his master. That is one aspect. The other aspect of affection is that a chaste servant cannot ever tolerate any insult made to the master. And this is exemplified by the example in the fourth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam by Sati. Again, Srila Prabhupada writes in the fourth canto purport. He writes about Mother Sita also, the same thing. And here we see he is speaking about Mother Sati, the same thing. He's saying, whenever there is a consideration of chastity, Sati, this wife of Lord Shiva and daughter of Daksha, is considered first. So we hear from the fourth chapter of the fourth canto how there's this episode where Daksha is about to perform a yajna, and Sati sees all her relatives, they going to participate in the yajna. And Lord Shiva doesn't want her to go, but still, against the wishes of Lord Shiva, she nonetheless goes there. And when she reaches with the entourage and with all these associates of Lord Shiva, her experience is noteworthy. She sees that she is welcomed by all her, you know, her mother, her other sisters, and they are very happy. But then she observes that not only her father, you know, is unhappy seeing her, her father doesn't welcome her. Not just that, she could have tolerated that. But she sees that there is no arrangement for oblations being offered to Lord Shiva. And seeing this, Sati just can't tolerate. And, you know, before we know the pastime, how ultimately she ends up giving up her body. But then before she gives up her body, she expresses her affection by glorifying her master. And there are these very, very beautiful adjectives she uses for glorifying the exalted position of Lord Shiva. She says, Lord Shiva is Ati Sayanaha. He has no rivals. He is Priya Atmanaha. He is most beloved of all living entities. He is Mukta Vairake. He is free from all enmity. Gunamscha Falgun Bahuli Karishnavo. If someone has even a small little good quality, Lord Shiva glorifies him like anything. He magnifies it greatly. He is Pavitra Kirtim. His fame is very pure. One whose fame is very pure. Alanghya Sashanam, whose order is never neglected. यद्वि अक्षरम नाम गिरेरितम नृणाम सकृत प्रसंगाद अघमासु हंति तत् हुज वेरी नेम कंसिस्टिंग ऑफ द टू सिलेबल्स शिव प्यूरिफाइज वन ऑफ ऑल सिंफुल एक्टिविटीज ही इज विश्व बंधवे ही इज अंटू द फ्रेंड ऑफ ऑल लिविंग एंटिटीज विद इन द थ्री वर्ल्ड्स एंड ही इज लोकस्य यद वर्षति चारिशो अर्थिनस फॉर द कॉमन मैन ही फुलफिल्स ऑल डिजायर्स एंड शी कंटिन्यूज हर ग्लोरिफिकेशन एक्सप्रेसिंग हर अफेक्शन फॉर हर मास्टर बाय मेंशनिंग दैट यू आर कंसिडरिंग लॉर्ड शिवा एज अ ऑब्नॉक्शियस पर्सन हैविंग यू नो ऑल दीज कोट अनकोट फिल्दी गार्लैंड्स अराउंड हिज नेक बट देन ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड even great personalities like Lord Brahma, they pick up these flowers that are offered at the lotus feet of Lord Shiva, and these great personality, they place that flower on their, you know, on their heads with great respect. And Srila Prabhupada, he glorifies in the purport, Srila Prabhupada glorifies this attitude of sati. And Prabhupada says that it is useless to condemn a great personality like Lord Shiva. And this is being stated by his wife, Sati, to establish the supremacy of her husband. Since Sati was a chaste woman and the wife of Lord Shiva, it was her duty to establish the elevated position of Lord Shiva, not only by sentiment, but by facts. So this is an expression of affection. This is an expression of chastity. And again, from the life of Srila Prabhupada, we see, you know, through so many of his writings, through his classes, through his conversations, through his dealings, the extent to which Srila Prabhupada left no stone unturned in glorifying the Supreme Lord. In spite of his, you know, old age, in spite of all these difficulties, you know, running a worldwide movement, in spite of so many cultural differences, Srila Prabhupada was so valiant in establishing the supremacy of the Supreme Lord. And that is a symptom of his affection that he carried within his heart for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And not by sentiments, here the purport mentions, not by sentiments, but by facts. So Srila Prabhupada's display of affection was not just sentimental. Prabhupada said that if you want to understand this Krishna consciousness movement, we have so many books for you to read and understand. Otherwise, this movement is very simple. Just chant the holy names of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So that is one aspect of displaying affection. The second aspect of displaying affection is that a chaste servant can never tolerate any insult to the master. And here, once again, Sati, we see, she cannot tolerate the insult to her master, Lord Shiva. She's saying that, you know, sometimes during our casual conversations, whenever Lord Shiva, he used to call me Dakshayini. Whenever he used to refer me as the daughter of Daksha, she says, all my jolliness, at once I would become morose, and my jolliness and my smile at once disappeared. Because previously, you know, previously Daksha had insulted Lord Shiva in that assembly. And after that incident, whenever she was referred to as Dakshayini, she used to feel so morose, and she used to feel worthless. And Prabhupada writes that since Sati was a chaste, So Sati is saying that I feel very much sorry that my body, which is just like a bag and has been produced by you, I now decide to give that up. You know, not Acharya's comment that, you know, Sati, she was actually glorified by Lord Brahma, Srishti Sthiti Pralaya Sadhana Shakti Reka. She had that potency, she had that capability of maintaining Srishti, maintaining the entire creation, Srishti Sthiti Pralaya, you know, destroying the entire creation. Could she not have destroyed Daksha? She could have very easily destroyed Daksha. But then later on, others would have commented that Lord Shiva, you know, he employed his wife to, you know, counteract his enemy. So just to save that disgrace from coming upon Lord Shiva, Sati says, it is better for me to give up this body which has been produced by you. And in the 10th canto, the other episode where Lord Krishna and Balram, they go into the forest for bringing these firewood for Sandipani Muni, and they get caught up in the thunderstorm and everything. After they return back the next day, Sandipani Muni, he says, Atma vai praninams preshthas. One's body is the most dear to any living being. No one can just part with one's own body. One's body is most dear to oneself. And both of you, you endangered your own lives, your own bodies for my service. That is how Sandipani Muni is glorifying. And here we see the same instance. The body is so dear to Sati, you know, so dear to every living being. And here Sati has decided to give up her body. Giving up something that was supposed to be dear to her, but for the sake of someone more dear, who was her master. So this is another characteristic of affection. Not wanting to tolerate any insult for one's master. And repeatedly we again hear in the examples, in the classes of Srila Prabhupada, whenever there is any mention of Daridra Narayan, you know, we repeatedly hear in Prabhupada's classes, you know, Prabhupada is so heavy. They call it Daridra Narayan. How can Narayan be Daridra? He is the master of the goddess of fortune, and you know, thousands of Lakshmis there wanting to serve Narayan. How can someone just call Daridra Narayan? All of these people are like, you know, typically Prabhupada used to call them fools and rascals. So heavy upon people who mentioned this concept of Daridra Narayan. So yes, being affectionate, having this affection for the master, is also a characteristic of chastity. The next characteristic, symptom of chastity, is that one is satisfied in the association and one is satisfied with the service to one's master. Not looking for pleasure anywhere else. And the example in this case is of Sukanya. Again, from the 9th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, the story is one of the sons of Manu, King Saryati. One time he visits the ashram of Chavan Muni, along with all his entourage and his daughter and everyone. And his daughter Sukanya, while playing with her friends, she observes some glowing substance in the holes of the earthworm. And she just pricks those, you know, effulging substance. And immediately upon that, all the king and his ministers, they find their complete inability in passing any wastes. And King Saryati could understand this is because of some offense. And he asks all his minister, you know, tell me, who of you, kisne kiya ye kaam, you know, who has done this mischief? Definitely some of you have committed this some offense to Chavan Muni because of this, you know, we are going through this calamity. And then, you know, Sukanya, she comes and very meekly she admits that, you know, I didn't know, and you know, just I kind of prigged. And King Saryati feels very bad, and he begs forgiveness from Chavan Muni. But it is described Chavan Muni is very angry. And King Saryati doesn't see any other way how to pacify this great soul. And then King Saryati offers his own daughter, that is Sukanya, in marriage to Chavan Muni. It is described that Chavan Muni was at the level of the grandfather of Sukanya, such an old person. And he was not young, but indeed old enough to be her grandfather. And he was also very irritable. And here was Sukanya, the young daughter of a great king. And of course the story goes on that how Chavan Muni is actually, Sukanya actually serves her husband very faithfully, and she is satisfied with that service. And Chavan Muni observes that, and when Ashwini Kumars, they when the Ashwini Kumars, once they come to the ashram of Chyavan Muni, he asks them, can you give my youth back to me? So Ashwini Kumar, they said, okay, let's take a dip in the lake nearby. And it is said that Chyavan Muni was so old that the Ashwini Kumars had to literally carry him and, you know, get him to the lake for taking that dip. And when all of them take that dip and they come out, all of them are effulgent young personalities, very beautiful. And Sukanya is confused. Who amongst these three is actually my husband? And that is when she closes her eyes and starts praying to the Ashwini Kumars, please reveal yourself and please reveal to me who is actually my husband. And then Ashwini Kumar, being pleased with her, they reveal Chyavan Muni to Sukanya. And later on, Bhagavatam describes that how King Saryati, he is about to perform this sacrifice, the Soma Yajna, and he comes to the ashram of Chyavan Muni to invite him. And there, to his utter dismay, he sees that his daughter is sitting next to a young man. And King Saryati is furious. He is saying, oh, unchaste girl, what is it? What is this that you have desired to do? You have cheated the most respectable husband who is honored by everyone. For I see that because he was old, diseased, and therefore unattractive, you have left his company to accept as your husband this young man, please listen very carefully, who appears to be a beggar from the street. Oh, my daughter, who were born in a respectable family, how have you degraded your consciousness in this way? How is it that you are shamelessly maintaining a paramour? You will thus degrade the dynasties of both your father and your husband to hellish life. But Sukanya, however, she was very proud of her chastity, and upon hearing these rebukes of her father, she smilingly told him that actually the person you are sitting next to me is actually your father-in-law. And then she describes the whole incident, and King Saryati is so pleased with her daughter, with his daughter. And he blesses her. And there, of course, Chyavan Muni, he gives the somras to Ashwini Kumar, and the story continues. The essence is, again, you know, all of these personalities, you know, they demonstrate by their example how one is satisfied, how there has to be satisfaction in the service of one's master. No? Yeah. Okay, Prabhupada gives another example wherein he's speaking in a Bhagavad Gita lecture in London, and he's saying that I have seen in maybe 1935 or 1934, Prabhupada saw just a small scene on the side of a street, side of a road. And he said that, you know, I saw this on the roadside, there was a beggar. The face of the beggar was defaced. Might be some accident. His eyes and everything became defaced. He could not see. Everything became useless. So here he was sitting on the roadside, and his wife also sitting. But I saw that the beggar was neat and clean. The wife was also neat and clean. The wife's business was to keep the husband always neat and clean and fresh and bring him there and again take him at home. Young woman, so I could understand that the wife is so chaste. She has not left such ugly husband because his face was defaced, and helping him because they require some money. So we have seen. So again, these examples, they demonstrate that how satisfaction in the service of one's master is a strong characteristic of chastity. Personally, I have also witnessed some families where, you know, they used to have these, you know, cooks who have been there for ever since they were small children. They came into the family for cooking, and now they are very old people, but still serving. Because of their affection, because of just being satisfied, not wanting to change from one place to another, just being satisfied. And someone was mentioning, in these days of the pandemic, the rates of the cooks have gone so high. Someone was mentioning cooks are now charging to the tune of 30,000 rupees per month for just, you know, serving their quote-unquote master, which of course they don't consider as masters. But then, yes, and again in Srila Prabhupada's example also, Srila Prabhupada always mentioned, everything is there in my books. Everything is there in my books. And therefore, in other words, there is no need of jumping here and there. Because this curiosity of jumping here and there will kill you. Curiosity kills the cat. And therefore, the example is given that all that we need to do to find those gems of realization is to dive deep into the ocean. Just by trying out different oceans, one is not going to, you know, get those gems. Here is this ocean of devotional service, this ocean of realization, and anyone who dives deep in this ocean of bhakti is bound to get those gems of, you know, Krishna conscious realizations. So yes, being completely satisfied in the service of one's master. And the last characteristic, apart from being, no, the second last, there are two more. So, another characteristic is being trustworthy in carrying out the service of the master. So, chaste servant, he understands the intent of the master and he carries out the instruction of his master without crossing boundaries. The example is from the Ramayana when Vishwamitra, he takes Ram and Lakshman to the palace of Janak Maharaj, and there is this big huge Shivapash, the bow of Lord Shiva. Vishwamitra, he says to Lord Ram, Vatsa Ram Dhanur Pashya. Pashya means to see, go and have a look at the bow. But it is explained that Lord Ram, he understood the intent of his master. He didn't just, you know, just go and have a look, okay. Done. I went and had a look. Anything else? Nay. Lord Ram, he could actually understand the intent that my spiritual master, he actually wants me to, you know, lift and string the bow. And that is what he did. But then, not crossing boundaries. Immediately when the bow was broken because of stringing it, immediately Janak Maharaj was very happy and everyone in Janakpur was very happy, and here is Mother Sita coming with the garland, about to put that garland around Ram, and Lord Ram, he took a step back. Come on, this was not part of the contract. I was just asked to go and have a look at the bow. I can't do this without the sanction of my father. So this is the, again, trustworthiness. Carrying out the instruction, understanding the intention without crossing boundaries. And when Krishna, he wanted to send someone to Vrindavan, because Krishna could actually understand the pain that the Brajvasis were undergoing because of separation from Krishna. Krishna was looking for someone trustworthy who could take the message of Krishna and, you know, console the Brajvasis. And for that matter, he chose Uddhava. He say, it is mentioned about Uddhava, Vrishninam Pravaro Mantri Krishnasya Daita Sakha Sishyo Brihaspate Sakshad Uddhavo Buddhi Sattamaha. Uddhava was such an exalted personality. He was a very intelligent and trustworthy personality. That is why he was picked up by Lord Krishna. Another example is when Rukmini Devi, she was overhearing all these news that her brother is planning to marry her to Shishupal. She couldn't take it and she had to do something urgently, and she composes this beautiful letter, and once again, she catches hold of a trustworthy Brahmana who could understand her intention, who could carry out her instruction, and who doesn't, you know, cross the boundary, who doesn't break that confidentiality that was there between, that was supposed to be there between Rukmini Devi and Krishna. And she says, Vichintyapam dujam kanchit Krishnaya prahinod drutam. Dark-eyed Vidarbhi was aware of this plan and it deeply upset her. Analyzing the situation, she quickly sent a trustworthy Brahmana. The word here used is aptam, someone who was reliable, someone who was trustworthy. And in this section of Rukmini Devi sending her message to Lord Krishna, in the last verse of the chapter, Srila Prabhupada gives a very pristine understanding. He says, when the Brahmana arrived, He broke the seal of the confidential letter written in the privacy of Rukmini's quarters and meant only for Lord Krishna. By using the term Guhya Sandesha, the trustworthy Brahmana personally selected by Rukmini here affirms that he has not violated the confidentiality of this message. Only Lord Krishna has heard it. So that is again an aspect of chastity, being trustworthy in carrying out the instruction of one's master. And the last symptom that we'll discuss today is being eager to serve the master. That is also chastity. Chastity is not a passive quality. Chastity is a very active phenomena that is exhibited by the master. The eagerness to serve more and more. Because it is said, to love means to serve. There is no meaning for a servant to speak that, you know, I love my master, unless and until there is sound service that is in place. And in the same lecture, same Bhagavad Gita lecture, Srila Prabhupada speaks the example, gives the story of a disciple of Sripad Ramanujacharya. He mentions that how this particular disciple, Grihastha, husband and wife, they are very poor. And one time, Sripad Ramanujacharya, he happened to come at their home. And he knocks on the door and there is no response. He could see that the door was not locked. It was just closed. And therefore, he could understand that the husband is not there, just the wife is there. And still, he knocked on the door and there was acknowledgement also. There was the acknowledgement of the lady coming from inside. Still, she was not opening the door. So Sripad Ramanujacharya could understand that, oh, they are very, very poor. And Prabhupada writes, so poor, this means that she was so poor that she had no garment. She was keeping herself within the room without any garment. So Ramanujacharya could understand, oh, there is his wife. Maybe she has no sufficient clothing. And Srila Ramanujacharya, he gives his own uttari. You know, he throws his uttari inside. And the lady, she wraps it. And then she comes and offers her obeisances. And, you know, she welcomes all the devotees along with her spiritual master. And she's so eager to serve. She's so eager to serve. She goes to the, you know, nearby grocer. And it is explained that how this grocer, he always eyed this young lady. And he always wanted to enjoy with this young lady. And this, she also, but she never succumbed to his advances. And this time, when she had nothing to serve her spiritual master, she goes to that very grocer and she says that, you know, I need some food grains, some spices and other stuff because my Guru Maharaj has come. And I want to serve my Guru Maharaj. And, you know, whatever you may want, you know, and tonight I will agree with your proposal. Please give me. Even at the sacrifice of my chastity, I want this. So the grocer, he was very happy. And he says, okay, no problem. Take whatever you want. And she takes everything. She prepares a very nice feast and serves Sripad Ramanujacharya and all his other associates. And that is when the husband, he comes in. And husband comes in and sees that everything is, you know, nicely done and the service is nicely rendered to the spiritual master and everything is perfect. So in confidentiality, he asks, how could you do it? We have nothing with us. How could you get everything to serve our spiritual master so nicely? And that is when, you know, this lady, she admits that, you know, this is what I have promised and this is how I got all the stuff. And the young man, the husband, he also said, yes, you have promised, all right. Then take some prasadam and go to this grocer, go to him. Because you have promised to meet him this evening, so go. And then the grocer heard the whole story. He took the mahaprasad of Sripad Ramanujacharya and his heart also changed. Oh, such a chaste woman, such a faithful. She, you are my mother. You take more ingredients, more grains, whatever you want, as much as you like. So Srila Prabhupada, he gives this example to demonstrate that how eagerness to serve one's master is a strong characteristic of chastity. Because, and here in this particular verse also, the Yadu queens, they are demonstrating that life is of no use where there is no service to one's master. And then just to conclude, it is said that, you know, there is this word called bhavan. A house is a bhavan, a place is a bhavan where there is service to Bhagavan, where there is presence and where there is service to Bhagavan. Wherever there is no service to the Supreme Lord, it just becomes like a forest. And similarly, because, you know, we know that the Supreme Lord is also staying within our heart. The Upanishads, they mention how within the heart there are these like two birds sitting on the same tree. But then one bird is busy enjoying the fruits of his labor and the second bird is just watching. But then when the other bird willingly starts offering the fruits of his labor to the Supreme, to the other witnessing bird, that is when the place actually becomes a bhavan. So just to summarize all that we discussed today, we discussed the virtue of chastity that is demonstrated by the Yadava queens in this particular verse. And we learn from these ladies how to reignite our own chastity when it comes to establishing our relationship with Krishna. And we discuss these six facets, six symptoms, characteristics, parameters by which we can evaluate our own chastity as a servant to the Supreme Lord. The very first aspect we saw of being committed, willing to go through anything to serve the Master. And this commitment is tested over time. We saw the example of Mother Sita and Lakshman. The next we saw being honest in acknowledging one's position and being honest in acknowledging the help that is offered by the Lord. And we saw the example of Rukmini Devi refuting Lord Krishna's arguments for her wrong choice. Then the affection for the Master, establishing the supremacy of one's Master, not willing to tolerate any insult to one's Master. We saw the example of Sati not tolerating insult to Lord Shiva and giving up her body. Then being satisfied with service to the Master, not looking for pleasure anywhere else. Prabhupada also said, everything is in my books. And we saw the example of the chastity of Sukanya, how she was satisfied. She was satisfied in serving an unattractive and, you know, invalid person. What to talk of satisfaction of, you know, serving someone who has all these qualities and someone who is supremely attractive. So that is satisfaction. And another aspect of chastity is being trustworthy, understanding the intention of the Master, carrying out the instructions intelligently without crossing boundaries. We saw the example of Lord Ramachandra. We saw the example of Uddhava taking Krishna's message to Vrindavan. And we saw the example of the trustworthy Brahmana employed by Rukmini Devi, who was sent to Dwarka with her message. And finally, the eagerness to serve. We discussed how chastity is not a passive, but a very active principle of devotional service, seeing the example of the disciple of Sripad Ramanujacharya. So yes, definitely, when we also, you know, remember these characteristics, that how we, there is a need for each one of us to be committed, to be honest, to be, you know, affectionate, to be satisfied, to be trustworthy, and to be eager to serve the Supreme Lord. These parameters, we can evaluate our own chastity in relation with the Supreme and endeavor to improve from the position that currently we may be in. So thank you all very much. Sorry for going a little overboard. Hare Krishna, Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada ki jai.